anyone remembers the heyday of the brown military FPS phenomenon, where Call of Duty was totally dominating gaming, and, you know, where Halo once was kind of like the top dog in terms of multiplayer FPS. You know, Halo 2 obviously introduced online multiplayer that was huge at the time. But with the release of Call of Duty Modern Warfare, that really kind of mixed things up. I think people were getting sick of the sci-fi shooter trope. I think there were a lot of Halo killers, as they called them at the time, which were really just low-quality rip-off sci-fi FPS games with a focus on this multiplayer aspect, and it seemed like the entire industry was trying to recreate the success of Halo. And then ultimately, when Call of Duty Modern Warfare came out, that it completely blew Halo out of the water in terms of popularity. It really had that kind of meathead college bro gamer demographic, which, I mean, Halo had a little bit of that. I mean, in terms of, you know, the frat house multiplayer LAN kind of vibe, which I partook in back in the day as well, which was fantastic. However, I mean, the military angle really did help Call of Duty push itself to the forefront of the entertainment industry culturally. You know, it was just ridiculously popular. Everybody was playing Call of Duty. And I've read a lot of journalists and people make the observation that Call of Duty is an example of gaming being used as a platform for propaganda. Because it is, ultimately, this kind of glorification of the military. I think we can agree on that. Even when it tries to be edgy and you have those missions, you know, where the nuke goes off and then, you know, the soldier who you're playing as dies in a nuclear firestorm and you're like, yes, food for thought, war is bad. However, look at all these cool guns in multiplayer, you know, like, you know, it got a lot of people into US military culture. And during Call of Duty's original heyday, it was a completely different political landscape in the US. I mean, you had George Bush, who was president. There was a neocon status quo happening where a lot of the propaganda at the time coming out of Hollywood and also the media were carrying water for the invasion of Iraq, intervention in the Middle East. That kind of was the consensus at the time. It was the narrative being pushed that America is obviously completely, you know, justified in this war on terror, right? That is what the propaganda was trying to spoon-feed us throughout the decade of the 2000s. You look back and, you know, how did gaming play a part in that? Well, yeah, I mean, you got Call of Duty, you have the era of military shooters, and I'm not criticizing any of these games as necessarily bad, because, I mean, ultimately, the propaganda is there, you accept it for what it is, it's pretty obvious, but you're also enjoying a pretty sweet first-person shooter. And I mean, personally, I was never really into Call of Duty. I did prefer Halo. I did prefer the sci-fi setting, and yet Halo is an extremely jingoistic military game. Almost even more so than Call of Duty, in terms of just how the humans fucking hate those aliens, you know? Fuck those aliens, right? And the aliens are like a religious, borderline Islamic hegemony, you know, like where they will suicide bomb you. They are incredibly fanatical in their alien whatever, their wish to exterminate humanity. So hey, you know, Halo's hilarious, but you look back and you can clearly see the propaganda of the time kind of mixed in there, and that, you know, it was obvious at the time as well, right? It's not exactly the most sophisticated stuff, but we can all agree that we had some fucking great games. And you even had a couple of weird, you know, outliers sneak in during that era, like, you know, Spec Ops The Line, for instance, right? Which is this Apocalypse Now brown military shooter that doesn't glorify war at all. It actually is just, it makes it out to be this horrible, like, that's a very subversive game. Like, I respect the fact that they even managed to get that made, right? Because it is kind of just saying, yeah, you want a military shooter? How about one where you have to, like, bomb women and children with white phosphorus? That's like part of the game. You know, hey, are you enjoying yourself? But I mean, it's a different era now. I mean, the idea of having a subversive twist on genre tropes, that's kind of almost overdone now. It's a cliche. Really, no matter where you look, I mean, Netflix, Hollywood, and then now gaming, the modern propaganda is woke propaganda. And there is a kind of philosophy of wokeness that involves inverting things, flipping things on their head. It's an aspect of postmodernism that you see everywhere, right? Like, you see it in modern art, right? When some guy frames a toilet bowl and then says, this is a great piece of art, this is a masterpiece. Well, what's the implication? The implication is anything can be anything, in the same way that I can cut my dick off and claim I'm a woman, right? So, yes, this toilet bowl here is art, and it's worth $500,000, millions of dollars, right? Because when you hear people talk about my truth, you know, I'm going to speak my truth. Well, it's another example of this, isn't it? It's that perception is totally subjective. That is the implication. So we're getting this now, this movement, part of it's artistic, part of it's philosophical, all of it rooted in Marxism. You know, this is the new propaganda of our current time, and it doesn't lend itself very well to entertainment. Like, you know, the relatively unsophisticated military jingoism of the previous generation, right? Like that, at least you could still get a good game out of it. I think that's the point. It's that ultimately, okay, I'm playing Call of Duty. Yeah, I feel a little guilty seeing as this is just saying, yeah, let's go over to the Middle East and fuck shit up, right? You know, on behalf of Israel. But, you know, I played a game called Full Spectrum Warrior back in the day, right? And it was another military strategy game. And it was just hilariously, like, you know, the US military had actually part-funded it. Like, the beta of the game was used in military strategy and tactical training, you know. So the game itself was kind of produced by the US government, right? So, you know, hey, I'm playing that game. You know, yeah, okay, it's kind of funny. I mean, one of your soldiers is like an Iraqi American, and he himself is just really stoked to be blasting Iraq, right? It's like, yeah, okay, great, thank you. Really fun game though, right? Because I guess that's the point. It goes the same really for Hollywood of the same era too, you know, and also in the 90s. It's that, sure, film has been used as a medium for propaganda since the dawn of the industry, right? So I get that, but you can really see how a kind of pro-American, you know, faux patriotic, jingoistic, neoconservative propaganda, despite being kind of cringe, is nowhere near as annoying as the woke propaganda that we have now. Where, look at a game like Wolfenstein. Like, I've mentioned this before, but it boggles my mind how the original Wolfenstein, the id Software original shooter, right? That is a hilariously over-the-top, just pro-America, like the Nazis are cartoons, Hitler is the last boss and he has like a robot body with his head in a jar. Like, it's just ridiculous. It's just clowns on the idea of this, you know, the National Socialist Party, right? Whereas the new Wolfenstein, because all the developers, they're obviously like these weirdo European hardcore leftoids, like big time, because that is the modern culture of Scandinavia a lot of the time. They're really into their leftist theory there. So that's what we get. You know, the developers are shilling for their ideology, and it spoils what could be an enjoyable game. I mean, the New Order was actually pretty decent because it maintained the kind of grindhouse, clowny, jokey aspect of the setting of World War II, you know, where Nazis are like, they have robots and mech suits. It's just over the top and ridiculous, right? That's the point. But then you get the new Colossus, and it's like really cringe because they're trying to maintain a level of the over the top vibe, while at the same time, it is like unironically, yeah, we fucking hate Nazis. Kill Nazis. By the way, Nazis are still a problem in our modern society. They're all over the place. We have to smash them. And then you have a strong Afro black woman. We have to have an Afro toting black woman because this is the modern gaming industry. So yes, Afro black woman, fuck Nazis, fucking gouge their eyes out, saw their arms off. Yeah. It has that element of sicko kind of a vibe, which Last of Us Part 2 also has this weird sicko leftist lust for violence. You can see that all over the place. I think that is another layer to the modern propaganda that we get these days, which is kind of, it's an attempt to try and justify the idea that violence against one's political enemy is totally, it's fine, right? That's part of being a communist. Violence is not only an option, it's encouraged, especially against, a Nazi, right? Or a landlord, you know, a kulak, an oppressor of some kind. Yes, by the way, you know, Trump supporters are Nazis, and anyone that doesn't want to get the, you know, Fauci ouchie, well, they're Nazis too. Violence, you know, so you see that this is not a road that really any sane society wants to be going down, but that's what we get in our modern propaganda, and it supersedes the need to actually make a fun game. Because look at Call of Duty now, look at the military shooters of our contemporary period, Battlefield as well, for instance, right? Where they have, like, a random one-armed woman who's like the squad leader, and she's killing Nazis and bashing their skulls in with this club, right? And, you know, with a smile on her face, like a smirk, like an almost feminist smirk on her face. Like, yeah, it's time for you to die now, chuds, you know? Like, this doesn't really feel like an authentic, you know, World War II kind of atmosphere, to be honest, right? And yet you say that, and then the industry points a finger at you and goes, ah, you hate women. Like the CEO of DICE himself, he pointed out how am I supposed to tell my daughter she can't play as a strong woman in a World War II FPS shooter setting? I can't do it. We have to do better as an industry. So yes, front cover, it's going to be a woman, and Afro black women are going to be the main characters of every game. And they're going to be really bloodthirsty too, because this is now the way it goes, right? And the problem is, it's just not conducive to the creation of actual entertainment that's worth anything, right? It just takes you out of the experience, and it's too obvious. The fact is, I think propaganda that's like a war propaganda for the US government, and they stick you in a war setting, and you're a soldier, okay, like, fine, you know, it's going down. You know, the spoonful of sugar that's the sweet multiplayer and the awesome 60 FPS, like, Twitch fucking gameplay, right? That's awesome. And then there's this, like, jingoistic, like, military shit going on. That's fine. Enjoy it for what it is. Now, I mean, what the fuck, right? What the fuck? Having just men in a military shooter setting is now considered offensive, because actual history is now offensive. So we need propaganda to correct that. So, you know, the next generation of gamers, the Zoom Zooms, they're going to just be playing this trash, and they'll think to themselves, of course women fought in World War II. In fact, they were probably the real heroes. In fact, the real heroes of World War II were black Afro women. Why do we still have first-person military shooters when it almost seems like the glorification of the military would be problematic? Well, I don't think so. I think neoliberalism in this kind of woke form that we have now obviously is like one of the main exports of the US. It's the cultural export of the US. And the US may have to enforce this wokeism through the force of their military. Like, they may have to. I mean, they attempted to do that in Afghanistan. Now, it didn't work out. But hey, you know what? We may have to try again, because I don't think the Afghanistani women really know what's best for them. They need feminism, and we're gonna bring feminism to them, whether they like it or not, and we may have to actually start drafting women to fully utilize the force of our military in order to get this done, because it's for the good of humanity, okay? You're gonna get woke, or you're gonna die.